And he with me. Well, what happened was the next day after the service, the Sunday morning service, an usher gave him his card back. And it had been dropped in the offering plate. And below his message was another verse, Genesis 3:10. And when he opened his Bible, he read what it said. And he said, "I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked." And that is actually the first response to sin, was it not? I heard your voice in the garden, and I shrank back in fear because I was naked. Who told you you were naked? God asks. How did you understand? How did you come to see that? You were clothed with my goodness and my righteousness, but now you see yourself in a new way. And only God then can clothe us. Remember, he tried. They tried to clothe themselves. What did they do? They took some figs is typically what it's described to be, and they tried to clothe themselves with that. But what did God have to do? He had to clothe them. What did he clothe them with? An animal skin, the first sacrifice. God himself is the one who made the first animal sacrifice. In other words, it is by the shedding of blood that there is atonement for sin. And so even there from the beginning, that first sacrifice was an illustration of this reality that the only way now back to union with God because of the alienation is going to be the shedding of blood. Yes?
Can you clearly define where worry stops and where being wise and being aware that we live in a painful world and our natural stewardship of the knowledge that God gives us to avoid that pain?
Yeah. He's asking about where does worry stop and knowledge and wisdom come in and so forth. And I think a lot of this is going to be to realize that worry is a kind of an emotion that we need to be aware of. And when we find ourselves being fearful and worried and anxious, we need to use our emotions, not to squelch them, but to acknowledge them, because they really are going to be revealing something about our thinking. And so in my view, I think of emotions as diagnostic tools that can help me think. Why am I so fearful? Or why am I so angry? Or whatever. What is it that, what have I embraced? What wrong thinking have I embraced? So in my thinking, wisdom invites me to see things from God's perspective, and that requires the renewal of the mind, whereas worry invites me to move away from that perspective and begin to look at the circumstances like Peter did when he saw the waves rather than looking at Christ. And so as soon as you get your eyes off the face of Jesus, back on the waves, what happens? It all consumes us once again. So that's why that phrase, unconditional surrender, would be something, actually wouldn't be bad to put on not once a year, but every day, to be honest with you, a way of presenting yourself to God on a regular basis. Because this is a stance. It is a faith stance. It is one of confidence. It is one where you put on the armor of God in Ephesians 6. And the whole imagery here, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, that whole notion there, that shield of faith will actually guard you from the flaming arrows of the evil one. So there is this warfare we're immersed in. And so we need to understand that. Yes?
There is also healthy fear.
There are healthy fears, yes. And there can be a healthy fear. Well, give me make sure I know where you're going.
Proverbs 1:7.
Fear of the Lord. Absolutely. That's what I was saying before, that you're going to fear something. It's either going to be the world around you, or it's going to be the fear of the Lord. That's why I say you will fear in the direction of your hope. And that's why a healthy fear is the fear of the living God. And I think that's a perspective. I came across this thing in all places in Eric Fromm, Man for Himself. I love that name. Just a great summary of where the guy was coming from. This was from a Jewish reader, and he writes about this, a man by the name of Susia. Once Susia prayed to God, "Lord, I love you so much, but I do not fear you enough. Lord, I love you so much, but I do not fear you enough. Let me stand in awe of you as one of your angels who are penetrated by your awe-filled name." And God heard his prayer. And his name penetrated the hidden heart of Susia, as it comes to pass with the angels. But at that, Susia crawled under the bed like a little dog, and animal fear shook him, and he howled, "Lord, let me love you like Susia again." And God heard him this time also. You see, if you were to see him as he truly is, you'd be crawling under the bed. You see, that's the awesome power of the living God. But a healthy fear of God is a mindset and the fear of God can be described in many ways. It's described as a reverential awe. It can be described as the attitude of a subject before a great and mighty king. But there's another dimension to it too, that the word phobos that's used of the fear of the Lord in the Greek New Testament, and similar to the Hebrew word in the Old, is a word that can also mean holy terror. And it's this notion here that God is the only true basis for having a fear object. You will put your fear, your hope in something. And what I believe is, if I fear something more than I fear God, then what's going to happen is I will identify my true master. Because you see, when I fear something or something, someone or something more than I fear God, then that really tells me what I truly worship. You're going to worship something, you can't avoid it. Something will be at the center of your aspirations and your heart. Better make sure it's the living God. So that is a healthy form of fear. Having that healthy and holy form of fear is a good thing. God actually protects us a great deal. None of us have really experienced much when we think about it. Even your most intimate moment, he has cushioned you at 1,000 removes from his true awe. If you were to see him even for a moment, you'd be undone. But the idea of praying that he would be your hope and he would be your fear object. But there is no fear in love, because perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves punishment, 1 John 4:18 says. And the one who fears is not perfected in love. What does he mean by that? What he's saying there is that form of fear is one that is a fear of punishment. That's not what we're talking about. It's not that God's going to get us, because actually there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But rather it's a holy awe and a terror of the divine displeasure. It is, in fact, to believe that you are playing to that audience of one, and so your deepest aspiration is to be pleasing to him, and your deepest fear is to incur his displeasure. Not because you're cringing in fear that he's going to beat you up or punish you, but because he is the hope and he is the foundation, he is the basis for your life. So that's, I think, what Robert means by a healthy form of fear. Yes.
Is it the lack of faith that's causing so many people to get on anti-anxiety drugs?
I do think that there are three things that contribute to imbalance and to a lack of mental health. One of them is organic. Another one is psychological trauma, for example. And a third can be spiritual. And I think we do well to see that all three can or could, one, the other, all three, two, could contribute. And so in my view, that if there is a chemical imbalance, there is nothing wrong in fact, addressing that any more than you would do that if you had some kind of stomach ailment and you'd take something to address that. That's an organic issue. So it's not to say that that's a problem. It's to say, though, that we do well to explore all those possibilities. But in my view, sometimes the medication may be necessary to put us in a position where we're able to think clearly enough and then to respond correctly. So, Glenn, you want to make a comment on that, if you don't mind?
Sure.
You're the expert.
I'm talking about depression, for example.
Depression, yeah.
We know there's a neurobiologic underpinning, and there's always a spiritual component to that. So what I see most often in the Christian community is with depression, which doesn't necessarily mean a feeling of sadness. It can mean you can have a feeling of emptiness, you can have a feeling that you feel flat, you feel not connected. Is that you don't feel your connection to God as well. You feel alienated from everyone else, you feel alienated from God, and so your prayers can fall on deaf ears. With medication, as Ken was saying, when the depression lifts, your sense of connection returns, and the sense of connection to God returns to the world as a Christian.
Yes. So it enables you to make that reconnect. And that's really the key here, is whatever we can do to reconnect with that. And I think it's really a more balanced perspective, in my view, that's necessary. I think it's very important. at any rate, what we see here then is this great and high calling.